Kim, on this session, I want to start off with you and I. You never know where we're going to wind up with the Holy Spirit.
Very true.
But I wanted to just lay a foundation to start talking about asking big. Go big. I mean, if you're going to pray and if you're going to have communion and intercourse with God in the things mm-hmm. you're saying and the things you're talking about as you go about the day, then go big. Too many people think too small when it comes to prayer, and God is wanting to elaborate and stretch and extend our faith and our ability to believe Him for big things. I learned this lesson through a lot of things in life, but one of them I was going to tell a story about. I call it my Titanic prayers, because one time when I came to LA, I was doing a school. This was maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And at the end, I'll do it for a week. And then at the end, I always schedule myself to go treasure hunting because I love antiques. So I'd finished and I got in the car and I thought, let's go. And I'm always inviting the Lord to go with me. You know, it's like, let's go have an adventure. And I was saying, let's go. I wasn't saying anything out loud. I was just thinking as I was driving, because I got the directions where some antique stores were. And I'm thinking, you know, Lord, I've been doing this for many years. I've been, you know, going to antique stores all over the world and hunting for treasure. And I always say it was before the movie came out. I always had an interest in history and about the Titanic. It was always something I was fascinated with. And I was thinking, never spoke the words out. This was my thoughts. You know, I've been looking for many years for that newspaper that came out the day after the Titanic, you know, sunk, and then the ship, the Carpathia, brought him into the port in New York City. And I thought, I would love to hold that newspaper and read those articles. I'm thinking this. I thought, you know, Lord, that would really be fun sometime if I could come across that. Now, you guys, you need to understand, I'd been doing antiques and I mean, all over the world. I would go into shops for many years, even in Southampton, where the Titanic sailed from. So I go into this shop and, you know, I walk through it and then I go into the next one. I'm walking down this aisle and I look over and all of a sudden in a china cabinet, I see a newspaper that is on this display thing. And this was more, it was more furniture than it was anything else. And I'm thinking, this can't be. And I walked over there and sure enough, that it was the paper, original newspaper from the Titanic. So I'm like having a glory dance, and the owner came by, and I told him the whole story, how I just thought that. And I said, you know, would you mind if I can't afford it. It was like $400. I said, I'm not going to buy it, but it would mean so much to me if I could just sit and read it. Jesus, sure, go ahead. He goes, I have a copy, you know, that you can buy. And I was like, okay, I'll take it. So I sat there that day and I read, and I was like, God, you care about the most minute detailed things in my life. This is amazing. I didn't even pray that out loud. I just thought it. And so the next day I caught my flight back to Dallas, and I called my kids in. I was like, Keisha, Eli, get in here. I got to tell you the story. So they came in. I told them the story. I just thought it. And then all of a sudden here's this newspaper. So the next day after that, I was going to Southampton to Graham's church at the time to do a school on the prophetic. So I check into the Star Hotel. It's an old hotel in Southampton, England. And I'm in the lobby, and the new manager comes up and starts talking to me. And she says, you know, are you, you know, what are you here for? What are you doing? And I told her, and she says, well, have you, you know, are you going to go sightseeing? And I said, well, I've been here before. She goes, you know, there is you have an interest in the Titanic. There's a museum. And I said, actually, I knew that. I think I'm going to show off, you know, all my skills of what I know about it. So I started talking to her. She goes, well, she goes, you'd be interested in knowing that actually the owner of the hotel. Now, this is like 4 days after I've just thought this, and I've never seen anything on the Titanic in all the years. Now, I've seen a newspaper, and she begins to tell me how the owner was the father and had a son on that ship who was a steward. And he had a boat license to be able to run one of the rescue boats. And so it was a rescue boat number 13 or 11, one of those. And she says, I have his original telegram that he sent from New York City. I go, are you serious? She goes, would you like to see it? I go, oh my gosh, that'd be amazing. She goes and she gets it, she copies it, and she goes, I'll make you a copy. I said, I will treasure this copy. So she hands me the copy. I'm going, this is unbelievable. I fly back. I go, Keisha, Eli, you got to get in here. You won't believe this. And so they come in. I tell them the story. Eli goes, Mom, that's amazing. I think he was in probably ninth grade or something. And he would come after school. He would come and sit with my personal assistant when I was pastoring a church at the time. And so that evening he came home and he goes, Mom, I have a secret, but I can't tell you. I go, what is it? He goes, Joy has something that she thinks she wants to give you, but she has to check with her children first. Now, Kim, this is like 1 week after I just thought this prayer, just thought. And all of a sudden, Eli, the next day I go and I said, Joy, Eli said, I'm supposed to see you. She slides the shoebox across the table to me and goes, Dean, I had to check with my children, but they said, you know, you would probably appreciate it more. I go, appreciate what? She said, appreciate this tin. She said, my great uncle was on the Titanic. Oh. And he was a little boy. She said, I never even knew his name. We all called him Ty because he was on the Titanic. She said, the story goes, now, I have no way of verifying this. I do know and believe he was on the Titanic, but that doesn't matter whether this was the original tin or not. It says Captain's Office, SS Titanic, little snuff box. But she told the story how Captain Smith loved butterscotch candies and would keep him in that tin. All right. It's a good story, but the point being was that now in less than a week, I have three things that I just thought, you know, Lord, it really would be fun sometime. And when she handed this to me and gave me this little tin, I actually started crying. I was just so overwhelmed. And the scripture, Ephesians 3:20, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. So many times I think people think, okay, you know, that means something around ministry. That means something, you know, concerning praying for souls or praying for healing for people or, you know, spiritual. And when in actual fact, I think it's just about God just enjoying our company and just enjoying a relationship with us and us being able to, you know, have internal prayer. That's what I did that day was an internal communion. I told you early in the first session is that inner life, that inner place where you commune with God and you talk with him as you go about the day, you know, and as you're interacting with other people, you're still communing with him. I just thought those thoughts. It was just something I thought, and he took that and he did something so amazing. And that taught me, be careful what you think, because we need to start thinking Titanic thoughts and prayers. Titanic. Big.
That's beautiful. Yeah. Titanic thoughts. Okay, let's talk about a few things. The law of attraction in you in terms of your desires, your good desires, of course. People think that's totally irrelevant. Why would God even want to give that to you when the world is falling to pieces, when there are hundreds of thousands of Syrian people that have been killed, and they are, you know, you've got Putin up there, Tutin, and doing all the stuff he's doing, trying to destroy and start a war with the United States of America and whoever else. Why would God be interested in that? And my mother used to say that to me when I first came to Christ. Yeah. She used to say, he's so busy, why would he be interested in your silly little things? And yet, you've just said exactly what I wanted to say, and that is, he delights in the prosperity of his people.
Yes.
And so we have to get rid of that religious idea that I cannot ask because I don't see it in the Bible. Well, first of all, we've got to look at the word desire. Mm-hmm. He'll give you the desires of your heart. Obviously, if they're ungodly desires, he's not going to give it to you. However, seek first the kingdom of God. Like you were saying, look, we should be praying for souls and praying for healing. Well, that's given. You do that anyway. You should be doing that. That's part of your life. But he does say something unusual. And Jesus said this himself. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all of these things shall be added to you. What is your take on that? Because I think if you've put the kingdom of God first and foremost, these things will come to you. These things will be drawn to you, and not something you don't want.
Right.
It's something that he knows is in your heart.
Okay, so my take on that, and I love that verse because it's built over the years. Holy Spirit has really built that into my life. And as many heard, even in the first session, I'm really big on the inner life, developing your inner life. Well, where is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is within. So if you're going to seek first the kingdom, it's a journey of going inward to commune and have fellowship and righteousness, peace, and joy, you know, in the Holy Ghost are part of the kingdom. So you don't, and I am a big, I don't know what's the right word to use. It's not a judgment thing on me, but I get frustrated, Kim, with people who are always singing about the glory coming or the fire coming or let your glory fall. And I understand that. I understand that it comes from without. But for me, it's something that we practice from within. We carry the glory. We were baptized with the Holy Ghost and with fire. We have that fire within us. And for me, I think what it does to the church is makes it powerless because people are still what they're looking, waiting for something to happen, something to come before they step out. And it takes the responsibility yeah. off people from stepping out and being the releasers of it. When in actual fact, when we begin to seek first the kingdom of God, that authority, that domain, that reign of God is within us. And we come into that place and begin to have that communion and fellowship at which then springs from there and everything else falls into place.
I love what you just said. It's excellent. You know, the the desires of the heart and the law of attraction.
Yes.
Now, I love the story of Hezekiah because, and I tell it a lot because look, people just don't get it. God gives a word, for those that don't know this, to Isaiah the prophet, which means it's final, and says to him, tell him to get his house in order, for he shall surely die. Of course, he had a disease. And what he does is he gets, and we know this, but for those that are watching,
right.
So you'll get this mindset out, get this out of your head, that he doesn't want to bless you. If you are sowing by sharing the word and feeding the poor and doing what you can do, believe me, he wants to give you the desire of your heart. The desire of Hezekiah, that sounds like a good song. The desire of Hezekiah, it was to live. Maybe he had grandchildren. Maybe he felt he hadn't finished his life. And yeah, he was dying of a disease that would kill him. Puts his face against the wall. And unlike what most people would have done, he begins to remind God. He said, don't forget the good that I've done.
Right.
Don't forget what I have done for you. You know, that could be... I think in most Christians' thinking today, that would be wrong. And I've done it, and he really likes it. When I'm praying, yes. He likes it when I say, don't forget, by the way, that this is what I've done. It's not, I'm not saved by good works, but certainly good works is part of our makeup. It's the essence of Christianity. So he loves it when I say, God, do you remember that time that I didn't want to leave my house because I wanted to be with my children, but yet you wanted me to go to Detroit, Michigan, to do a series of 5 meetings. And I remember so angry, I was so upset. And I got to the airport and I was angry and I thought, why do I have to go? I wanted to be with Jacqueline. I wanted to be with my children. And it was such a sacrifice. And as I was sitting there, a lady walked by and she said, oh, I want to tell you something. And she told me a story about how I came to their church. And I remember that happening years before. And even that time, I was upset about leaving. Mm-hmm. And she said, you came and she said, you looked tired and you were tired. But you called me out and you spoke about my daughter who had left home. And she hadn't been home for 8 months. And she said, you prophesied she'd come back. And the following week, she came back and came to Christ. And as she said that to me, I thought, there is such a reward in sacrifice. And so that whole story, you know, I was telling you early on, we think that God, we do something for God. He blesses us the next week or the next month or the next year.
Yeah.
And then it's all over. God doesn't forget. And I was going through some of my files that are years old. And I came across a song that I sang in Paris, France. The first time I went, there were thousands of people, and I was tired. And I sang this song about the Lord to the people, to the Parisians, to the French people. And I sang it at the end of a fourth night where we'd done like three meetings in the day. I was so tired. And you can hear it in my voice. It's tired. But I start singing the song from the Lord where he sings, "When I look into your eyes, how I feel."
Yeah.
And I'd forgotten about that song. And I was going through my files the other day, trying to categorize them. And I wrote, and I came across a song. And I thought, what song is this? And so I put it on, and it sounded terrible to start. I was just about to put it off. And I heard the French translator trying to translate the song of the Lord. Uh-huh. And the Spirit said to me, I want you to stop and to listen to the song. By the time I'd finished the song, I had tears in my eyes. I was so moved. The Spirit of the Lord is all over me. And the Lord said to me, I remember that song like it was yesterday.
Oh.
That was so precious to me that you were so tired, but yet you took the time to touch. And I remember what happened after I sang that song. A girl came crying forward and just screaming and crying for God. And anyway, the point I'm trying to make is we think, we forget, we have bad memories. He doesn't forget.
Right.
So sometimes, like you were saying, we ask for something thinking, well, do I deserve this? It's not a matter of deserving it. It's a matter of what God said. It's something you can do. Hezekiah was bold. He stood before God and he said, I'm reminding you, therefore I want an extension of life, which was given. He was given another 15 years. What you just said is very important, Dena, and that is about people constantly praying for the glory to fall, for revival to come. And what happened is when the initial day that you were filled with the Holy Spirit, that all was placed inside of you. Then there are infillings of the Spirit, which lead you to prayer, to pray different things. But actually, it's really up to you to let that happen. And I totally believe what you said.
When it says, out of your innermost being, in some translations, your belly shall flow rivers, I actually believe that. I actually believe that it's something that not necessarily everybody sees, but that there's issues that come out of me. It says it comes out of like if we're in him and he's in us, and it says, as he is, so are we. It says lightnings come out of his hands. I believe issues flow out of my hands. It says that we were baptized in the Holy Spirit and in fire. And it talks about a river of fire that comes forth from God in the book of Daniel. I actually believe that that river also is a river of fire that comes from us, that we, you know, and I've been practicing this and really asking the Lord to bring more revelation. First of all, I believe there are gates that are in our body. I believe there are gates and doors that are in our body that we can literally open them wider and release more, that when we come into a place, and the old timers, they were able to do this. You know, they had intercessors, speaking of prayer, they had intercessors that would go and just go into a room and just begin to pray for revival in cities and the places they went to, and the presence of God would come and it would fill and people would start getting saved and come from all the surrounding areas. I believe, and I didn't intend on getting off on this, but this has been my passion. I feel like it almost is a cop-out, and it gives people an excuse not to do anything.
Yeah.
Because they're constantly singing about something to come to them when they actually already have it.
Very good.
If we begin to change those words, then you put it back in their court. You put the responsibility back in that person, and let the river come. Let the glory come from them. In fact, you mentioned Peter and his passionate Acts. You know, it was Acts 2.
Yeah.
You know, first sermon, and he says, you know, where Joel, it said, he will pour out his Spirit. And in Peter, it says, when Peter said it, he said, he will pour out of his Spirit. Well, when Pentecost came and the Holy Spirit came within us, then we pour out of the Spirit. He's not, and that's not to say, because I remember in South Africa, I experienced that. In fact, I've told a story the other day. Remember when Bill Hammond came and we were playing, you guys were playing, and the glory, the room began to fill with glory, the cloud, and Van slid off the drums, Danny slid down, and you slid down off the, and you guys were playing, and I looked around, and all of a sudden, there was a cloud in the room, and nobody could stand up. I couldn't stand, nobody could stand up. The glory came, it was within us, it was around us. Yes, it does, but it is released. And by the way, I wanted to ask you if you remember that story. Do you remember that meeting?
Yes, I do.
And do you remember Bill Hammond crawling across the stage?
No.
And then he couldn't stand up, so he knocked the microphone over, and he took the microphone, and he goes, "This is it." And that was all he preached the whole night, because this was it. It was the glory. But, you know, I think we would be experiencing far more if people begin to understand they're the releasers of it.
They are. You know what? The thing about this, there are three types of people that I've told about this. You know, this risk takers, caretakers, and undertakers.
Yes.
Undertaker is the one who just wants, is sort of the fatalist, says, you know, it's never going to work out. My father was like that. It was inbred. It was just in him. Everything, if you go on the street, you're going to be knocked over by a car. If you get on a plane, it's going to crash. It was always some negative. And I think that's why I turned out the extreme opposite. Remember the old covenant and the new covenant, as you know, there was a different to what, the old was different to the new, as we know. But Moses, for instance, received the Holy Spirit at times, and then it would depart from him. And so it would come. So that's where that idea is.
Yeah.
It's actually old covenant idea,
right,
where the Holy Spirit would come upon, and then they'd experience whatever, and he'd leave. In the New Testament, as you know, we have the infilling of the Holy Spirit all the time.
Yes.
So it's there. That's the difference. So the old idea is, for instance, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah.
That's good, yeah.
Whereas in this day and age, it's in us already. It was right. Put there, and it is released at the right time. So a lot of people get the idea, we must ask for the Holy Spirit to come, tarry, and then it comes. And there are no risks. There's very few risk takers in the world today. Mm-hmm. You are one of those people that is a risk taker. I know that. And that God looks at that attitude. Proverbs says this, and I always relate this to prayer, and then I'll let you just teach whatever you want to teach there for a while. He says, the lazy man says, there is a lion outside, I shall be slain in the street. So that is sort of the attitude. I'm not going to go out, venture out in prayer, venture out in faith, venture out anywhere because there's a lion outside. And actually, as you said, it's laziness. It's the wanting, well, it must come to me then. It must knock on my door. I must knock on its door. And that, unfortunately, comes into our prayer lives.
It's the fear of the unknown and the fear of risk-taking.
Yeah.
Stepping out, will he back me up?
Well, people ask me this all the time about being a prophet. You say, thus says the Lord. What if it hasn't come to pass? It hasn't come to pass before. I was reading some prophecies that I dug out of, you know, the files I was looking at, going back 12 years, that I see did not come to pass. Mm-hmm. So now what does that make me, a false prophet? No, it doesn't whatsoever, because I'm not under law. I'm not under the old covenant in terms of what I'm supposed to do. Did I make a mistake? More than likely, I may have missed it. So many people get very uncomfortable when I talk like this. They say, well, then you can't be trusted as a prophet. However, if you look at 90 whatever percent of the prophecies and that have come to pass, you can't just say, well, because you missed the timing here, or you missed, it was misinterpreted by others, or perhaps even by myself. Maybe I said, you know, there's going to be a president that's such and such, and then I even may have thought it may have been somebody else. Just because that happened, but that means I've got to step into caretaking mode. In other words, I'm not going to take a risk. And I've seen too many times where I've taken a risk and it's been right. And I felt, well, that was God. I'm not totally sure, but I'm going to say it anyway. And it comes out and it happens.
Right.
One instance, if you don't mind me just taking your time to share this, is I went to, actually it was in Houston. And I was under this thing about somebody had said, you know, you said this and it didn't come to pass, which by the way, wasn't correct, that they had misinterpreted what the Lord was saying. But anyway, I went into this church and I pointed out to a woman. And as I did that, this little voice said to me, what if you're wrong? What are the repercussions of if you're wrong?
Right.
And another voice said, but what if you're right? And I thought, to hell with it. I'm going to say it anyway. I did. And I said, thus says the Lord, you have a child who has a blood disease that was contracted by such and such and such, and her name is Priscilla or whatever. And this woman screamed and cried. Mm-hmm. And I said, now, because of what he reveals, he heals. That revelation is yours to use for her healing.
Right.
Now, there was follow-up, and the child did get cured. And the Lord said this to me when I heard about that, maybe weeks later. He said, what if you hadn't stepped out? Yeah. My word would not have departed out of my mouth. That woman would not have got the faith to push for a child for a specialist in some degree, and that child was cured. What if you hadn't done that? And well, that made me realize it's worth the risk of being called a false prophet to see the hundreds and hundreds of people that are actually touched, and nations now.
Well, I'm just going to bring a little bit more balance, because it doesn't tip to the end of your scale, Kim. You are obedient through delivering the words. But I think what most people don't understand about the prophetic, just because it's God declares it, doesn't mean it's going to come to pass. Mm-hmm. There's something that most people aren't willing to do, and that's praying that word. You know, watering it with prayer. Jeez. One of the things I do, I love developing prophetic words. In fact, Miranda and I were talking, you were out of the room, on a word you gave me last time I was here. And yeah. I've been developing this prophetic word. What do I mean?
You haven't announced it much, have you?
No. But what do I mean by that? Well, first of all, you need to transcribe it. You need to transcribe the word. And then when you go over it, there will be a prayer agenda in every prophetic word. Not only a prayer agenda, but then there's an action plan. I know we're talking about prayer, but that's the point. With a prophetic, prayer is such a vital part of the prophetic that most people aren't, well, you know, they just set that prophetic word there and go, well, it's got to come to pass.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean it's going to come to pass. There is an action plan. There is things that you have that it's requiring of you. If you do this, God will do this. There's things you need to pray through and find the right timing and everything else. I think some people miss their windows. I think some people, there's that aspect.
You're right.
Aspect, and I forget, I'm trying to think which psalm it is. It's in the Psalms where it says the word of the Lord about Joseph tested him until the word of the Lord was fulfilled. You know which one I'm talking about? That when the word of the Lord comes, often it's a promise, because God knows what you're getting ready to go through, that you're getting ready to be tested. You're getting ready to, you know, I cannot tell you how many times, you know, and you know this, you've given prophetic words about finances, and then the next week they lose their job, they lose everything, and they go false prophet. But actually, that word was to warfare. That word was a promise of what you're going to come out on the other side and be able to step into while you're going through this difficult time.
And Dena, by the way, a lot of times people don't get that God was doing that to open something else up for them.
Yeah.
Some people get married to their job, and this is it. This is my source of supply, and they never open to anything else. So God has to remove that. Elijah, the greatest prophet at that time, and even to this day, is one of the greatest. Elijah, he was quite happy at that brook. Let me tell you, we think of this old guy sitting in a brook and just drinking. He was doing a lot of things. He was conducting his business. He had family or whatever that he was busy with. He was just sitting at the brook for 3 years. Yeah, he was Elijah. So there were a lot of things going on at the time. And then suddenly the ravens stop, the water dries up, because God knows the guy's getting very comfortable here.
Yeah.
And we don't know what was going on in Elijah's mind. He was saying, I'm taken care of. But God wanted him to go to the mountain so there'd be an abundance for everybody. You know all this, but people need to understand this. You may have lost your job. You may have lost something. And your setback may be a setup for something greater.
Absolutely.
That's where they lose their perception. I have had, when Graham Cook came here and sat over there and wrote the word of the Lord to me, about unprecedented favor, unimaginable favor. When I took the word from him and he left, I blessed him, he left. So I sowed into the man who gave it to me. I gave him an offering. And I said, thank you, taking the time to come here. And I said to myself, oh boy, am I in for it the next few weeks?
I know. It's
something you have to accept, everybody. Because prayer started, immediately I prayed. I didn't pray for the word to come to pass. I prayed for preservation and protection and understanding and perception of whatever happens now is not a contradiction. It contradicts, but it's not a contradiction. It's God doing all this, allowing all this to shift me.
Yes.
And so, oh yes, it came. I had one attack off the other. And every time that happened, well, not every time, sometimes I got a bit miserable, but every time it happened, I would say, every time you push me, every time you hurt me, every time you attack me, every time you hurt me to the enemy, you're pushing me a little bit closer to the promise of God.
That's right.
Go ahead.
That's right.
Do it.
Yes.
But I'm not going to condemn Graham Cook and say he's a liar because suddenly it didn't just unfold. The trouble is we are instant people. We want something to just fall out the sky. And we don't realize he's creating a presence for us to receive that, or a space for us to receive that. And so I went through probably 8 months of terrible warfare. And every time it would happen, I'd say, I know it's because of unimaginable, unprecedented favor.
Yeah.
And Joel even got a beautiful old book put together for me. It's called El Libro Kim, I think it was. The library, or the word, what's it called? The Book of Kim.
Book of Kim.
And what the words is, and the first thing that Joel put on there, got them to describe, was the word given by Graham Cook. And that was a sign to me. Like the Lord said, I want you to know it's coming your way. And boy, when it hit, it hit. I can tell you many, many things. And it's only just started, that favor that he spoke about. So I want people to understand that the prayer is not necessarily always, resisting the devil. If it is, then certainly resist him by just proclaiming, I'm very happy that you're doing this because I know that you are afraid that that word will break and come to pass. But the second thing is God perhaps shifting me from the brook of provision to the mountain of abundance? Or maybe on my journey there's a woman that might not lose her son because of this brook drying up. And I was placed in her way, and so on and so on.
I'm going to say this because it's something I've lived, working for many different ministries and in many different ministries, and being, watching church life. I've seen this over and over. God will be wanting to move that person, whether they're on staff or whether they're in the congregation, whatever. And they are digging in because they're having a glorious time. They're flourishing, whatever the case might be. But God has something more. He did that to me. In fact, every time he's ever shifted me and moved me, he starts drying things up. He starts stripping the nest, so to speak, and things become uncomfortable. I've watched people blame the ministry because they dug in and they didn't move. And so they start finding fault with the ministry, fault with the leadership, fault with this, fault with that. And they get bitter and they take on offense and all this other stuff. In fact, the last place I was at, I could feel that things were starting to shift. And so I went to my leadership and I said, I'm just letting you know, I'm asking the Lord. And they said, thank you, Dena. And I said, one thing I won't do is it's not about you guys. It's about the brooks drying up, and I feel there's movement. And I can honestly say after 35 years, Kim, I don't have one bitter bone in my body about any ministry I've ever worked with. And it wasn't always a pretty sight sometimes, but I've always recognized there's a bigger picture going on that sometimes we don't understand, but that brook drying up has always saved me because I've realized, wait a minute, this isn't about people. It's about, what are you doing, God? Maybe you're wanting to move me to the next thing. And when you ask questions like that, you stop looking at people as your negative, problem source, and you start seeing it that it might just be a powerful transition that's getting ready to take place in a promotion. And I've stepped into those moments, and I'm always feeling and always looking, but it really does tie in with the whole thing of just having that communion. One thing I keep hearing us loop back around in, and it's just the whole inner life and having that kind of relationship where it's a back and forth. And prayer isn't just about us talking or coming with list or coming with that kind of thing. It really is about, that communion of the give and take and being able to listen as well as,
Dena, when Graham Cook gave me the word, I wish I had a chance to read to the people. I think it's on our website, actually. He actually said something in the thing that would have been an audacity to a person with pride. And that was, God's going to lead me into a new way of praying. Now, I mean, you're talking about the creme de la creme of prayer warriors.
Yes.
I'm serious. I'm there. I'm not lying. Sometimes it's an hour and a half to 2 hours just on one session, where there's a beautiful spiritual intercourse that's going on. There's love, there's intimacy, there's times where it just gets that, I'll just sit down and he'll say to me, just lie on the ground now and just look at the sky. There's so many things that I get into.
It's unique every time.
And you know that. But he'll whisper things. He'll say somebody's name, and then I'll find a scripture, and I'll just, like I did for Danny.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that whole thing was because of prayer. So, but yet he came along after 30, you know, 5 years of me praying like this and saying, now he's going to lead you into a new way of interacting with the Lord. And I looked at that and I thought, well, he doesn't really know what I do. And the Lord said, hold on, this whole word is from me. Yeah. So therefore, there is something I want you to learn. And Patricia King came on to our show. And Patricia King, in her own unique way, without knowing this, I had prayed to the Lord, what do you mean by a new way of praying? Mm-hmm. You know, I said that. I said, come on, Lord. I'm already old now. I'm not young. So, and she said something. She said, one day God said to me, because, you know, when you pray, there's a presence that comes in. I don't know if a lot of people understand that. I even say to the Lord, okay, I would like a love message from heaven.
Yes.
Whether you send a bird, whether you send whatever. And he'll do it every time, you know. And it's just something that I expect him to do.
He comes. Yes.
Yeah, he does. But she said, God said to her, for a season, I don't want you to expect any of that. Mm-hmm. I don't want you to rely on any feelings, or that kind of thing for a while. And I just want you to go in there and be silent before me for a season. And so I tried, that didn't work. But I went in for me, because that God told her that. But then a new realm of praying started happening. And I can't explain it, but it's different. And it's so I'm seeing that there were conditions in that word too, mm-hmm. that I had to step into before that unimaginable favor could come to pass.
Well, and you know this, but I'm just saying it for the people as well. We can never exhaust the understanding experiential things of prayer. There are realms we've still yet to discover. I mean, when you look at James and how it talked about Elijah being, you know, a man like us, yet he was able to pray and stop the rain, and then, you know, 3 years later, you know, praying the rain would start back up. I mean, you know, how many are moving at that place and at that level? There's so much more that I believe God is wanting to do, and realms that he's getting ready to release to people that think maybe they've hit up their plateau on prayer, but I know I haven't. I know I want to experience more. And Kim, I'm going to tell you in a minute, but I'm laughing because as you're talking about Graham, I just remembered, I've forgotten about this. I just remembered a prophetic word he gave me, and I am fulfilling it now through you.
Wow.
I'll tell you about it in a minute. I want to hear yours first.
No, I think you should tell it. It's fine.
Well, maybe 18 years ago, he prophesied over me in a conference and said, Dena, you're going to do TV. Now, I've always loved the medium. I love it because I feel like I'm right there with one, but yet it's with, you know, millions or whatever the case might be. And I'd done a little bit, but I wasn't happy with Christian TV. And when he said that to me, I almost wanted to go, la, 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 I'm not listening. And I took the word, I transcribed it, and I just said to the Lord, Lord, I don't know if I can get an agreement with this. If you can do something where it's creative and it's something that isn't, you know, religious feel to it, and I started giving all these things, I go, you know, I don't know that I want to do it. But Lord, I believe you're so creative that the day's coming that you'll open a door where I can do something that is creative by nature and natural. It doesn't have that you know what I mean, that religious TV kind of thing on it. And then look at us sitting here, and I forgot all about that. Actually, I went back and I repented, and I said, Lord, this was several years after, which was probably just a few years ago. I said, Lord, if I did anything of shutting that down, that prophetic word down, from coming to pass, I remember doing this back when I was living up in California, Northern California. I said, then I repent and please forgive me. I apologize because I don't want to resist what you want to do through me. And so I opened up and said, I would be happy, Lord, when the time comes. Here we are.
And I believe that it is the time as well. Because I remember when we first came to Hollywood, remember? And I came and I did the whole thing. And we spoke about you coming over here and being part of it. Mm-hmm. And I knew it was right, but we were financially stricken because we went into that building and then we had everything go wrong. I mean, everything went wrong. We had the crowds, we had everything, but we ended up in a lawsuit that cost us so much money, almost destroyed me. And so I got angry and I went into Detroit, was my like my safe haven. And I said to the Lord, I want you to speak to me. And I want you to open up another door because I'd like to leave California. Uh-huh. We had, I think, 4 lawsuits in 2 years.
Unbelievable.
Bad ones.
No, I didn't know that.
Unrighteous ones.
Right.
And I said, this is the litigation capital of the world. I mean, they just... Anyway, so I said, you know, I've had enough. If you sent me there just to strip me and to embarrass me, the economy's, you know, it's so difficult to even afford anything there. I said, I'm ready to leave. But in the meantime, I will bless you from Detroit because this is where I feel free. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I got on the platform. I don't know if you guys remember this. Got on the platform and the Spirit of God is moving and I turned and pointed myself and prophesied over myself. And I was... I was completely out of control. I was stopping my finger from pointing at myself. And the Lord said, did he say, go back there. That's where I've ordered you to be. Yeah. And a new thing shall open up for you and all this. And I'm thinking, what is he talking about? And so it all started working when this started happening. And we moved away and found ourselves a place 30 miles or whatever from Los Angeles and Beverly Hills and everywhere. And decided, well, if I'm supposed to reach the people in the industry, well, then go ahead and they must come out here.
Right.
And I sort of got that attitude was, I don't care about anything. God just make it work. And then, of course, the internet opened up and the crowds grew and they grew and they grew. And God started giving me this unbelievable favor. And now with our discussions today, look at your involvement already.
Yeah.
Now we're able to... to bring you in,
and
it's all about timing. And I wish the people would understand that. What is prophetic prayer? You know, we have many different evaluations of that, and you can perhaps even touch on this now. Is that once you watch and pray, once you perceive, you need to pray what you perceive, what you have perceived. In other words, God says to Abraham, "Look." There's a difference between look and see. Mm-hmm. Look is casual observation. See is acute perception. He says, what I want you to do is I want you to look. He uses 2 words. And whatever you see out of your looking, I'll give to you.
Yeah.
But you've got to go and put your feet on that ground. So I tell people in prayer that you cannot get anything without faith. And faith comes by hearing or perceiving, if you wish. And so God says, you're looking, but what are you perceiving? Because whatever you perceive, that I will give to you as you embark upon the journey. So... a lot of people just want this, like you said, bring the glory and bring this and bring that. And God says, I've already placed it in you before you were born. You know, when we started adopting these children from China, special needs children, the Lord really moved on me one day in the garden when I was quoting out of, I think it's Colossians. He could correct me on this one, but it says, we are his handiwork.
Yes.
Created in Christ Jesus for good works. Mm-hmm. That's what we created for. And that's why I believe in prosperity. How can you do any good work without prosperity? Yeah, you can do some walking and blessing. But we created it, which the Father prepared beforehand that I should walk therein. In other words, I said, God, I'm walking in exactly what you prepared beforehand. This day was prepared. All you needed was a body and a soul and a spirit to be there. So I'm at the right place, the right time, for the right reason. Yeah. So you have to have that boldness when you pray. Not this... I'm not sure. Then shut up. Don't pray then. But pray what you've perceived. Pray what you've received. That's a lot of to do with prophetic prayer.
You know, that the prayer of faith, the authority of the believer, these were things that were taught, you know,
absolutely,
back in the, during the faith movement and message. Yeah, there was errors. There was an imbalance in that. But I thank God, Kim, for my marination in that, because it saved my life, as you know. Mm-hmm. It has kept me...
saved my life.
It's kept me balanced because I pressed in to know even more. That's why one of the things that is so critical in prayer is to know your identity in Christ and who Christ is in you and who you are in him. And to have a strong sense of, once again, it's the inner life, that inner life of identity that you know. I mean, I never hesitate to say, he flat out adores me. Yeah. I mean, he's wild about me. He loves to hang out with me. I love to be with him. And that's the thing I was going to say earlier is that so much of what we're talking about, where you said, you know, taking risk and reinventing and finding out more, it's like a marriage. One of the things that destroys marriages is that people start growing apart. They're not interested. They don't keep common interest anymore in things that they can do together.
Which is friendship, yeah.
Yeah, which is friendship. And when I started telling the story about Titanic, that's what made me think of it. Because the concept, and I know it's foreign to some people, that he actually enjoys that about me. And I enjoy things about him that I'll go, let's go on an adventure or let's go do this, you know? And that I know the Spirit of God loves that I get excited about things. I can hear God smile over me sometimes. Look at her, there she goes again. She's getting all excited about this or that. But he put those things in me. That's why to pray and to commune with God around those things, because we've developed my relationship and that it's a marital relationship that, you know, I've stayed interested. And he'll never lose interest in me. We can depart from him, but he never forsakes us or leaves us. But that's important because it builds a confidence. When you approach God, I forget where the scripture, it says, you know, you need to have confidence that whatever you ask in his name, and it's a confidence of going, I know I'm right with God. His blood, the blood of Christ has cleansed me. God's not mad at me. He is celebrating me. He's for me. And, you know, there's so many scriptures in the book of John that talk about, you know, abiding in him and him, you know, loving us and wanting to give us whatever we ask. It says you have not that because you ask not. So ask that your joy might be full. And it's a joy unspeakable. When you begin to pray and you're seeing things happening, there's nothing that infuses you with more excitement.
That's right. And that's why I like having you on. My guest is not a guest. This is Dena McClure. She's a friend, and not a fair weather friend, been around for a long time. I love what you share, Dena, because the thing is, it brings life. Because we see so much evil, the news media is for some people, the news media is their best friend. Mm. First thing in the morning, CNN or Fox, whatever. Lunchtime, during the day, computer, what is it saying? What's happening now? And we very seldom apply as much time for input from the kingdom of God or from God himself. And that's why I'm fasting the news right now for quite a while. And it's so beautiful. It's so relieving. And so Sunil every now and then will say, listen, you need to know this happened.
Right.
It's a fulfillment of prophecy. It's something you need to pray about or that. But that'll be it. And so we have this bombardment of constant the negative. And then we have, and rightfully so in some instances, many preachers that say it's only going to get darker. Well, we know that. Mm-hmm. And morality is going to get darker. The world's going to get darker. What I don't understand, however, is how we don't see the other side. God's joy. You know, there are things in our home that happen. Matt Young may get upset and hit one of the girls. So we have to deal with that. We have to chastise. We've got to correct him. Does that mean that for the rest of that day, it's going to be that constant feeling of you did something wrong. You're not going to make me happy. I'm not going to smile at you. Mm-hmm. No, I put him on my lap when we're done with it. I bite his ear. I speak into it. I love him. I tell him, I love you, my boy. Now let's go on to the tennis court and let's have some fun. Or you know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so there's a father there that did what he had to do. But now we're not going to live the rest of the week. No. I haven't forgotten what you've done, my boy. So you better not get too bold and confident. Yeah. And strut around like everything's okay. Why can't he? He was dealt with. He had the chastisement. He took the punishment, whatever it was, whether it was timeout or whatever. And he deserves the happy side of the family.
The other goes against the very nature of God because it says God is love. And in 1 Corinthians, it says love does not keep an account of wrong done. So once it's confessed, once he deals with you, if we try to go back and remind him, he's like, what are you talking about?
Yeah, that's
you
right.
know, and one of the things that was, children, if you've had children, they help you understand the character of God. But early on, one of the greatest things that has saved me over and over and over again is the Lord said, Dena, you're running a race. It's not a race to see who finishes first. It's a race of endurance. So, sweetheart, when you trip, when you stumble, when you fall, I'm going to be on the side of that racetrack going, get up, keep going. We only defeat ourselves when we stay down. God's always about us getting up and continuing to run. I remember when Keisha and Eli were in, you know, how big they were in sports in South Africa. And I remember going to their little, you know, their little meets where they did the racing and the running. And I would be, I mean, I was up on the side of that track. I was running alongside going, yeah, and I was cheering. And he said, if you do that for your children, how much more? Do you think I'm doing that for you? I cheer you on. He doesn't hold things and beat us up. You know, he corrects us, but then he's like, come on, get up now. Let's practice it.
And Dini, you know, people carry that into their prayer life.
Yes.
Because we're teaching on prayer, and they carry that in there. I've done something wrong, and he's still upset with me. If you look at my household and the things that go on, you know, there is a tendency for kids and even spouses to carry something on further than what it's due.
Right.
In other words, if we've had a disagreement, it could go on for days, or it could just break it and stop it right there. That's the relationship is with God. It's not him. It's us.
Right.
So, for instance, Mia...
Yes.
Mia,
say that again.
It's not God. It's us.
It says God changes not. He's perfect. There's no shadow of turning. So if something's going off, it's not on God. It's on us.
So what happened was... Now, Mia Faye. Mia is just grown so beautifully for those who follow us and know about our children. And I've done this with all my children. And... She was corrected. She did something wrong. I took her one side. I said, this was wrong. You know that you should not have done that. I told you not to do that. Why did you do it? Because she gets tearful because I'm being stern with her.
Uh-huh.
And so I said, okay, you need to go and say sorry or whatever it is. So I give her the instruction, but I noticed an hour later, come, let's all go into the garden. Let's go and throw the ball. She's one side. She's just walking away. So now I know she's still holding that correction,
mm-hmm.
and she's upset. And we can either leave, I could leave her, or I'll just grab her and put her on my shoulders and run there, and she'll start giggling and laughing, and it's all over. That's how I see God. He wants to make it right quickly as possible. He doesn't
right.
want to sit there. He's not the one grumpy.
No.
He's not the one looking down, saying, but so we've covered that. So I'm just trying to say we take that into our prayer lives.
Yes.
He has an issue. Whatever you see, you be.
Yes.
So whatever you perceive, you receive. In the time of the children of Israel, and I've taught this before, but you can just jump on this as well, is they saw thunder, lightning. They heard the crack of God. They heard, it was terrifying. And they ran away from God and set up the prophetic order and said, Moses, we don't want to hear from him. You go, you hear, you tell, and we'll listen, which is a joke anyway. They never did. But anyway, so that was set up.
Yeah.
And Moses does something which people don't really understand. He went to God and he says, show me your glory, because I am so sick and tired of the judgments, of hearing you, you know, the thundering and the shaking from the mountain. He said, I want to see, and basically what he was seeing was beyond Christ. That's why he was taken onto the mountain with Jesus and Elijah. But he is
yes.
taken beyond that. And God says, no, I've you've got my power and my presence will go with you. He says, no. If your presence doesn't go, we're not going to leave you.
I want to go.
I want to see your glory. And the word glory there, you know, is interpreted as well, goodness.
Yes.
Because if I don't see it, God, I'm going to pray seeing the judgments. I'm going to pray seeing the lightnings. I'm going to be mad with the people. And I just want to see the other side. And so what he does is, and I know you know this, but for you, Moses is becoming a little tired of the stern God, you know, because of the way the people behaved, and God was just striking out and they're running away from him, and he knew this is enough of this. And God takes him, puts him in the cleft of the rock, as you know,
mm-hmm.
and proclaims, I am God, merciful,
yes.
kind, ever forgiving, visiting the iniquity. Goes onto this whole thing and shows himself to by declaring his goodness. So that when Moses does eventually come down the mountain, he's shining with the glory of the new covenant.
Yes.
He's shining with the glory of Christ. He's carrying the future down the mountain for the people to see.
Yes.
And what do? They say, cover your face. We don't want to see that side because they were so acquainted with the stern, with the hard, with the judgmental, that when he came with light shining, they said, cover your face.
Right.
So it's a very important lesson that we have to be balanced in our prayer life.
And that one line, I forget where it is in Scripture, where it says, I think it's in the Psalms, where it says, the children of Israel, they would look out their tent door, but then they drew back and limited the Holy One of Israel. And that has always, like it says, Moses knew his ways, but the children of Israel knew his acts, because he was willing to know the ways of God. You know, millions got to see the acts of God. I'd rather know his ways, because you'll automatically, you're going to see his acts. I don't want to just see acts. I want to know him. And that's what Moses said. I don't want to go. I want to know you. I want to show me your glory. And I love this because also, two things. When you were telling this, it made me remember, because I've said it over and over again, the times that I've traveled with you and known you over the years, you will always sing about the goodness of God. And it's like you begin to declare goodness and it precedes glory. It precedes the manifest presence. When I talk about glory, also the manifest presence of God, where you encounter and experience him. And, but you got to declare his goodness and understand and know that. I think also, maybe some of you have asked this question. I used to go, he was asking to see his glory. And God says, no man has seen my face and lived. And you think, well, he didn't ask to see his face. But in actual fact, that's what he was wanting. And you think, well, but it just got through saying you were in the tent of meeting. And you were meeting with him face to face. So what's the deal? It says that God's presence would be surrounded, because if he didn't, the people in his contact would be toast. But it says it was surrounded with thick clouds, with darkness, which is not depressing. And even uses the word gloominess in the old King James, but it means it was a concealment so that the consuming fire would not just, obliterate a person. And it would be like being in a fog. And not being able to, and I've been in some fogs where you can't see the hand in front of you, where he heard the voice. He was standing there with him, but he didn't see his form. He just heard the voice, but he was there.
I hate to interrupt you because you're doing so well, but that is new and fresh to me. And think about it. When Moses was, I've been fought about this, Moses was transported out of time and into the future, and he looks around and he's on another mountain.
I believe
Tavor,
that.
And he's looking at Christ, because the Bible says he knew Christ.
Right.
And looking at Elijah, and there he was. I mean, looking at Elijah and Christ, that's right. And there he was, and took the glory of that moment. By the way, that same cloud you're talking about came down and they heard the voice. And then was
the voice is always in the middle.
He was transported back, but carried something from that mountain back. And it was on his face, on his skin, the glory of God. So anyway,
Kim, I don't know too many people. I've always believed that, and you sound like you're almost like stepping out on stuff that's extra biblical. But I do believe when he went into the cleft of the rock, which was also a type of Christ, which was to come, pierced out of this side, came the church. And that when Moses went, he said, "Get up early, come up into the mountain." When he went in there, I've always thought that that's where he went, that God took him forward in time to the Mount of Transfiguration, and that he actually did enter the Promised Land, but in a way that, most of us would only dream of.
I even said once, I think God did him a favor by not letting him, because he did enter the land in another realm. I don't know why this happens with you, but it can go on for hours, actually.
I don't know when we need to stop.
Well, we're running at 57 minutes. That's amazing. I think we'll stop there, because most of you have been taught so much just in this one conversation, because it's really prayer. You cannot teach a person how to pray, the methods, and because each one will know how to pray their own way, but there are guidelines. And the biggest thing is attitude, how you go in and face God. Dena, where's the scripture that says that God hates the soul that holds back and withdraws? Now, I see it in the scripture. I hope the word's not hate, but it says he despises the person.
I would imagine that's in Proverbs.
It's either Psalms or Proverbs, where he says he despises the person who withdraws or holds back his soul from God. So I just want to encourage you. Yes, you may have sinned against God. You may have made a mistake. There are many of you that need the forgiveness of God. But how long are you going to grovel and cry out for God's forgiveness and say, "Lord, I did this and I'm doing it again. I'm going to help you with something today. I'm going to help you with something very big." Because this is our biggest problem. We can categorize sin, but sin is sin. Whether you say, "Well, I'm a gay and so I've got the worst sin in the world," that's a lot of nonsense. Because the person that lies is deceiving. And God speaks about the things that he hates more than anything. One is a prideful look, a haughtiness. These are things that he hates. Go to Proverbs and read. I don't know where it is now. I saw it a while ago. But the things that God hates. And maybe one of your sins are not there. What I'm trying to say to you is, When you come to God, yes, you need to confess your sin. Don't have unconfessed sin. Confess to, don't find somebody to confess it to. That's one of the worst things you should do. Maybe a very good friend, someone that you really, really trust. The Bible also says that if you are covering your sin, you will never prosper.
That's right.
So a lot of people say, well, Kim, my day, I cannot go through a day without sinning. I'll be honest with you. Whether it's in being impatient, or maybe I've been rude to somebody inadvertently, or maybe I had a thought of pride or whatever. There will be a time, a car may cut in front of you, may get a moment of anger or whatever and say something you never meant to say. These are things that we deal with every day. These are not things I'm going to ask God forgiveness for when I go and be before Him. I'm sorry, I just don't have time for that, and He doesn't either, because that's life. These things happen. But the Bible says he who practices these things.
Come on.
Now the word practice there is the Greek word praso, which is similar as a dentist or a doctor that practices on a patient that affects them, whether for good or bad. There's some medical doctors that have practiced on a patient and then taken advantage of the woman and had intercourse or raped or whatever. This has happened. What I'm trying to say is the word practice means it's what you do constantly, and it's completely affecting your relationships, your lives, whatever. That's where you've got to start thinking about, hey, listen, I need to deal with this. I need to get it out of my life. And I don't want something to be where it's a day and night thing that's in my head. Those are the things you need to concentrate on. And I don't want you to carry that into your prayer life, please. Because he doesn't want to hear you that stuff. It's like my son coming, I've said this before, my son coming to me, Jacob, and saying, well, Dad, you know what? I just went out there and I beat somebody up. And Dad, I'm so bad. You know, I had this bad thought. Dad, I said to him, listen, Jacob, I don't want to hear that. Is there something you can tell me that you did was good? So that I can be proud of you and not hear about all the bad things you've done. And there's something you really need me to help you with. Because it's not necessary. Now, maybe you'll find scriptures to contradict me. I do believe in speaking to God and saying, please, I'm sorry.
Can I give
please
you a
don't live there, please.
That would confirm this, because, and I won't take long, but I believe it's in Galatians where it says, the works of the flesh are this, list them, you know. And in Philippians, it talks about whatsoever things are good, lovely, pure, just, of a good report, virtue, praise. You know, and then Paul goes on and says, do these things, because those same things which you heard and saw and received from me, do them. It's that word that you're talking about. It's that word practice. And what you practice becomes habit. What becomes habit becomes part of you. And so it's like warring with the opposite spirit. If you know you've had, you know, things that are not pleasing to God, then begin to counteract it with the opposite spirit and practice it. Do it. Meditate on it. Think on those things. Replace it. You know, that's what I call that. Replacement theology.
That's a good replacement one, you know? Right there. I loved what you just said. You think on these things.
Practice it.
Because, you know what? I look at a human being and I say, there's so many good things I see in this person.
Yes, that's what the prophetic
should do.
Then
we have one or two things that I don't like. Am I going to just ignore every good thing about that person and say, that's what I'd like to speak about? Yes, I'd like to see you improve on that. But let's talk about your generosity. Let's talk about your love for others and your kindness and your goodness and your patience and your faithfulness and your long suffering, whatever they have, and enjoy that. So that's how God sees it. He says, when you come into my presence, let's get rid of the sin before you get there. If you've got something you want to confess, get it out the way. And please, for the next 10 minutes or however long you pray, can we just think on these things and pray? Sometimes I even say to him, Lord, you know, I'm so jealous of you. I wish I had all of your traits in me, in fullness. Well, and I go through the fruits of the Spirit. I say the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, faithfulness, gentleness, goodness, kindness, and long-suffering. And I'll say, Lord, I really want more of this. And he loves that kind of talk.
Well, and my kids are in their 30s, mid to late 30s. And still, Kim, and you know this, when they come to me, I still love it when it's not pressed. They say, Mom, I love you.
Yeah.
And they just come just to say, I love you. You know, God loves that. He doesn't want to hear us all our moaning and complaining. He just wants to hear us say, I love you.
You know, that's so beautiful, because that's the truth. Not wanting anything.
Yeah.
Sometimes I come there and I say to the Lord, I'm not here to ask for anything. Today, I'm just going to give to you. I'm going to minister to you, and I'm not asking you for anything. And he always somehow reciprocates with great rewards. And David even said those words. He said about the law of the Lord and the precepts of the Lord and all these different things that he said. He said, by them is your servant warned, but in keeping them, there's great reward. So think about the laws or the commands or the Torahs that you've kept.
Yes.
And remember, there's great reward in those. Lord, today,
yes,
we pray together.
Thank you, Father.
For these beautiful people, Lord God, that you have raised up to be around us. Let your wonderful presence fill their homes and lives right now. I pray, Lord, that they would sense the goodness of God. And that, Lord, as they raise their hands with us, Lord, break the power of this unnecessary war that they enter into. And that, Lord, they would enter into this time and moment with you, realizing that the God of the universe who created me is wanting to hear himself in me.
Yes,
and Lord, that's what I pray for, that God would hear himself in me. And I glorify you and thank you and impart upon them.
Yes.
Dean and I agree together and we impart upon each one of them the ability to pray that will touch the heart of God, that he would draw near to them as they draw near to him. And we thank you for that now. In the name of our Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.